So good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the seminar, IEEE Seminar Series. So today I'm glad to introduce you Professor Jan Makac from Czech Technical University. And he is from actually Department of Electromagnetic Fields, Faculty of Electrical Engineering, Czech Technical University. His main scientific interests are also, he will talk today, is the investigation of planar passive elements and subsystems of microwave technology, planar antennas, planar microwave filters, propagation of electromagnetic waves in built structures and materials. So, Professor Makac is an author and co-author of more than 250 publications. And he is also the MTP Society ADCOM membership and Geographic Activities Committee. And why he is here is that he is also the MTT Region 8 coordinator. So I will leave the stage to Professor. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you for introducing me. Good afternoon. I'm enough loud. You will hear me, it's okay. So let me start my lecture, substrate integrated waveguide. Base for lithium wave antennas. So, let's start. Here you see the evident comparison between classical waveguide with the metallic walls, and here you see substrate integrated waveguide. We can clearly see that, okay, this is okay, not exactly the relic of old technology, but it is still used. The main advantage of this classical waveguide is very low losses and the possibility to transmit big power up to one. Okay, you cannot, okay, here you can transmit, okay, maybe several watts, not more. So megawatt is okay with that waveguide. But for today, technology and industry, the aim is to produce thousands and millions of pieces of something, to produce that very cheap, very fast, and to have big profit. So you cannot integrate such waveguide to anywhere, okay, in the past. People used some thin lines to integrate, in fact, active circuits inside of this waveguide, but for the modern technology, this is not possible to use. Maybe it's just only in antennas for satellite TV, you can see the you can see metallic waveguides in the irradiator of that dishes, but not with the rectangular cross-section, but with circular cross-section. So, with the SIF, substrate integrated waveguide, we can integrate it, it's cheap. We can produce it, but just only having the PCB, printed circuit boards technology, and okay, that's very simple structure. Okay, the layout of my presentation, after short introduction, I in fact did that introduction. I will talk first about substrate integrated waveguide. Then I will, okay, introduce some antennas, leaky wave antennas based on that transmission line from the literature. And the second part of my presentation, I will show you the some results of our investigation in Prague at our department, and of course I will finally draw conclusions. Okay, I was talking already, today we need big mass production of thousands and thousands pieces, very cheap. And of course, we must integrate such systems. So for the high frequency or microwave frequency, we are using mostly planar technology. And that's why we are using that substrate integrated waveguide, because it is an analogy of standard waveguide. What can you do with standard waveguide with metallic walls? You can do in that substrate integrated waveguide. And the reason for using leaky wave antennas is first, they are very wide band and second in some applications that's very useful, that we can steer the beam simply by changing frequency. No need to change the structure of the antenna, we just change frequency. Okay. I think that substrate integrated waveguide is one of the most important innovations in the microwave technology in the last decade or maybe last 15 years. And I told you the reasons. It is a direct equivalent of that metallic waveguide, and it's possible to integrate it with its other planar transmission line, both its passive and active element. And for example, we can integrate antennas together with the input or output circuits. Okay, concerning the slide. If we have any open transmission line and we are able to excite along that line propagation of a fast wave at which the phase constant is lower than K0, where K0 is the propagation constant in the free space, then due to the phase matching we can excite that leakage wave. Of course, its propagation constant is complex. We have the phase constant and alpha is the attenuation constant because that wave continuously loses its power because part of that power is radiated alpha. And you see here, it's a theoretical calculation. Theoretically, the amplitude of that leaky wave increases to infinity. Of course, that violates the radiation condition, so in real antennas, the power or amplitude increases and then it should decrease because field cannot violate the radiation condition. And as I told you, that okay, here is the direction of the main beam, arcus cosine theta, over K0, and the gas of the width of the main beam, it depends on the attenuation constant. And the advantages of this antenna, first, it is non-resonant structure, so it could be wide band. And as I told you, we can simply scan or steer the beam just by changing frequency. Okay, concerning the open planar transmission lines used as lines on which we can excite surface or space leaky waves, the first one who built or designed the microstrip line leaky wave antenna was Professor Menzel in 1979. Professor Polinen then did the exact analysis of this transmission line. The first slot line leaky wave antenna was described by these guys, Sheen Lin, and me with my colleague Professor Zehentel. We studied and designed for a long time the leaky wave antennas based on the slot line. We first started with the standard slot line, but the disadvantage was that it radiates above and below the substrate. So we, to get rid of the radiation below the substrate, we used the conductor back slot line, but the problem was that this structure leaks power at any frequency to the substrate, and it's of course causes big losses. So finally we it went to the application of this waveguide that is really very similar structure to the substrate integrated waveguide. So that antenna radiated only in one direction above the structure and due to this metal walls, it okay, such structure doesn't leak energy to the substrate. Okay, and here we have substrate integrated waveguide SIW. It is a direct analogy to the metallical waveguides. Waveguides with metal walls, and as I told you, what you can do with classical waveguide, you can do with this structure. It is composed of the substrate, of some dielectric substrate, of some thickness, with the permittivity epsilon r. Field is confined from above and from ground by just metallic plates. And from sides, we have two rows of metallic pins that confine the field from sides. But using that structure, we can design and fabricate much more than the standard waveguide with metallic walls. So here we have that metallic pin, so that's analogy of this structure. Using here the, that is the active the part of the that waveguide, here that white holes are filled, just only holes filled by air, and here we have metallic holes, so we have something like this structure. Using only air holes, we have such structure, and we can use the structures with only one metal layer, and we can get analogy of such transmission lines. And of course, we can get the analogy of the TEM transmission line, something like coaxial cable or coaxial transmission line. We use just only two layers of dielectric substrate. In between, we have metal strip and the pins, metallic pins from sides, and we have transmission lines that is able to carry DC current. So we have TEM transmission line, something like coaxial line. And here you see, based on the simulation, that the wave propagating along the substrate integrated waveguide is exactly the same like the wave propagating along waveguide with metallic walls. The only one difference is that as we have discontinuous side walls, this structure can carry only TEN0 modes. That means modes that do not have currents they need to flow along the side walls. So that's the only confinement. We can use only these TEN0 modes propagating along substrate integrated plate. And you see here the distribution of the field in this structure, just in between two pins. Of course, in the between the pins, the field is a bit different, but depending on the distance of the pins, we must design the structure that really confines the field at these two layers, not like in this case. You see that the energy is partly the substrate. And the analogy between the classical waveguide and the SIW structure, here we have W is the distance of the pins, P is diameter of pins, and S is distance between two neighboring pins. And if we would like analyze that structure as standard waveguide, we have to recalculate this effective width. Okay, this is the first guess, this is the better guess, and back transformation from this width to this one can be done using this 4-1. Okay, and here you see exactly that perhaps very well. Here, solid line is the full-wave analysis of the dispersion characteristic, and that dotted line shows the application of this simple structure with the effective width of the waveguide. Okay. There are three kinds of the losses. In the metallic waveguide with the solid walls, we have only losses in the conductors. So depending on the material, the losses in the standard waveguide can be very, very low. Here, we of course have to consider conductor losses, dielectric losses, and radiation leakage. In this first picture, we have the dependence on frequency and substrate thickness of the conductor losses for the given conductivity of the material that I think is cheaper. Next is the dependence of the dielectric losses on frequency. And in the last picture, I have the radiation leakage losses due to the radiation. And here we have something like the boundary between non-radiating and radiating area. So it is said that for the distance between pin lower than 2.5 of the diameter of the pin, we have the losses sufficiently low. And here on this plot, you see the working region of that substrate integrated waveguide. Here in this half, we cannot realize that structure because the distance between pins cannot be lower than the diameter. Here, this is the overperforated region because S is still higher than D, but not so much. So here we have the radiation leakage, and here it is so-called band gap region because the side walls with pins, they represent the periodical structure, and we can reach the Bragg condition. Beta S is n times pi. That means that to get rid of that Bragg reflection, the S must be kept lower than 1/4 of the cutoff wavelength. So to design well working structure, we must be within this yellow area to keep sufficiently low losses. And here you can see the first antenna or leaky wave antenna based on this transmission line. You see that here at the edge of the substrate, the distance between pins is higher and the energy is leaked through in between that pins. This is so-called half-mode substrate integrated waveguide. That's due to the symmetry. There is no need to use the full width of that substrate integrated waveguide. We can keep only half of it to assure the guiding of energy. And next picture shows the radiation of that structure at two different frequencies in the plane of the substrate of the transmission line in the perpendicular plane. This is the structure I designed with my colleagues. Peter Lawrence was my student. It was seen behind this structure. We were sitting at the was at the time of European Microwave League in Munich. We were sitting in a pub and talking what we are doing. I showed him this leaky wave antenna. He told that he's working with his colleagues with such structures, so it was the impulse to design such antenna. I will talk about it later. This is the first structure proposed by Katsuo Ito, the mounted capacitors that introduce the series capacitor into the line that sidewall pins serve as an inductor, and this structure can leak energy through that mounted source. Again, I saw this presentation by Katsuo Ito at some conference, and I told him that he is surely the first one. I have very similar structure, I will talk about it, but I have it still in my computer, not ready for the application. Okay, here are the radiation pattern. You see that at low frequencies, the structure leaks energy or radiates to the backside. There is then a frequency at which we have a zero propagation constant, so the structure radiates broadside, and for high frequencies it radiates depending on frequency forward direction. I will talk about it later. Here is the advanced structure composed of two arrays with the slots, and depending on how you can feed these two separate antennas, you will get a different polarization. For feeding only one structure, you have linear polarization in this direction or in this direction. Feeding both lines, we have linear polarization along the structure, feeding both lines, but in the opposite orientation, we have linear polarization in this direction, and using the feeding with the out of phase, with the solid phase difference 90 degrees, we can get left-handed or right-handed circular polarization. Here are again the dispersion characteristic. Here is the K0 line, so in this area the antenna radiates left-handed and right-handed wave. I will talk about it later. And here it is the antenna designed to generate, to radiate the circularly polarized wave. Okay, here we have radiation patterns and axial ratio that defines the circularly polarized path. And this is the next step in the design of that structure that is also used here, only one transmission line, and with that source design, so that structure radiates circularly polarized path. Again, here are the S parameters of that structure and radiation patterns depending on frequency and axial ratio. Okay, into left-handed and right-handed. Here is the one of the attempts to design dual band antenna. I will show it again later. This is the equivalent circuit, electric circuit of this structure, and also show that antenna really radiates. That's the first band and the second band. Here you see that in the first band, the left-handed and the right-handed regions are not matched. We have still some gap here, but you see that here is the gain in the first band, gain in the second band, and the scaling possibility with the changing frequency. You can see how you can scan the beam, and some radiation patterns are calculated here. This is the next version of the dual band antenna designed again by the group of Katsuo Ito. Here it is not matched structure. You see here band gaps, and still here. This is the better design. So the two bands are with our band gaps, and again here is a no band gap, maybe it's a two bands. Okay. This is again the structure that depending on the load of that antenna you can increase the efficiency of the radiation, but this works only at the broadside radiation. And here is the attempt to design the structure with the reduction of the cyclops levels. So we have only one main beam. And this is the dual band antenna radiating in the first and second band. It was designed by me and my colleagues. So now I will start with the work done, or with the results of the investigation of these antennas based on substrate integrated waveguide and applied as microwave antennas. This is the structure I already showed you. It's the first structure when we can measure the S parameters, and this was the structure with the 50 ohm termination that is designed for the application. Okay, the design of that antenna, we used the analysis, way of the analysis, it was the application of the mode matching of the spectral domain method. We, depending on the basic structure, we for different slot widths, we calculated dispersion characteristics that was the phase constant, attenuation constant. For the effective radiation around 20 gigahertz, we used this width of the slot equal to 5 millimeters. We have designed the relatively well working transmission between the waveguide and microstrip line. And here are calculated and measured as parameters, so you see that the antenna can relatively well radiate between 18 up to about 26 gigahertz. Here is the comparison of the measurement and simulated with radiation pattern, and here you can see the measured scanning of the beam depending on frequency 18, 19, 20, 21 gigahertz. So it's the increasing frequency, the beam goes finally towards nearly forward direction. And okay, I think it would be good to talk a bit about metamaterial like transmission line in the general form. This is the general equivalent electric circuit of a transmission line with the length of the cell equal to B. We have a general value of the series impedance at S and general value of parallel admittance YB. And we can calculate characteristic impedance as second root of ZS over YB, propagation constant gamma, that is J times beta, the second root of ZS times YB, phase velocity is omega over beta, and root velocity is 1 over d omega over d beta over d omega. And now we can play as we would like with that transmission line. We can use any form of ZS and any form of the YB. Of course, naturally, for standard transmission line, series element is inductance because that corresponds to the storage of electromagnetic energy along the transmission line, and parallel capacitance that represents storage of the electric energy along the transmission line. Here we have a real value of the characteristic impedance, phase constant that increases its frequency, and that means that in this standard transmission line, wavelength decreases its increasing frequency. And phase and group velocities are equal for this lossless transmission line and are equal to 1 over the second root of LR times CR. Okay. But what happens if we change the position Z to reactive characters? Series capacitor CL and parallel inductor L sub L. Here, again, characteristic impedance is real, propagation constant is real, but negative, 1 over omega times second root L sub L times C sub L. And look here, phase constant decreases its frequency, and that means that contrary to the standard transmission line or standard propagation of the waves, wavelength increases its frequency. But there is one problem. We cannot design transmission line in this form, because these real elements must be mounted or fixed somehow. So in any case, we must use some hosting transmission line or hosting structure that keeps that elements mounted somewhere. So the real structure looks like this. We have here elements of the standard transmission line, series inductor and parallel capacitor, and here we have that series capacitor and parallel inductor. We can calculate phase constant, but we have such structure. In this area, propagation constant, its value decreases its frequency, so that's the case of the analogy of the left-handed transmission line or left-handed wave propagating in the space. Here we have some band gap, stop band, and in this frequency line range we have standard transmission line that corresponds to the wave propagating in the space with positive permittivity and permeability. This so-called left-handed wave or transmission line corresponds to the propagation of a wave in the material with negative permittivity and negative permeability. And what is so-called balanced transmission line, keeping these two resonant frequencies equal, we will get the line where there is no gap, so it is so-called balanced line. We have here at this frequency at zero that corresponds to these two resonant frequencies. The phase constant is zero, so for the wave propagating on the line, wavelength is infinite. And at this point, we have that so-called broadside radiation if we are designing an antenna. So, this is, okay, that's not so clear, but it's the picture of the first antenna designed by my group on that substrate integrated waveguide, and it was designed with the aim to use that antenna in the radar that served in the armed vehicles to protect that vehicle against the missiles shot that vehicle, for example, tanks. So that structure at one frequency, it radiated to the large distance and found the first time that missile and different frequency it searched in the near field, and it was used to measure the speed and the distance of the propagation of the missile. Okay, here are the dispersion characteristics. This red line corresponds to the left-handed band, where it's the frequency, the phase constant decreases. Here we have a right-handed branch at which the value of the phase constant that here increases, and this is case zero line. So, or as I showed you at the beginning of this lecture, the structure radiates just in between this frequency, and at other frequencies it's transmits just standard wave. Okay. Here are the calculated scattering parameters S11 and S21. At this point we have that broadside radiation, that's the condition at which the phase constant is zero. And so you see that here we have that left-handed branch and here we have that right-handed branch. Okay, here is the calculation and simulation by CST and measurement of the radiation pattern of that antenna. Here you see the simulated radiated patterns. Here we have that broadside radiation, and with the increasing frequency, you see the behavior of the radiation pattern. And here is what I promised you, George Alastriades. Okay, theoretically designed the conditions for dual band radiation of such antenna. We must have more complex equivalent circuit, keeping this condition, we will get two bands with the closed gaps. Okay, this was again attempt done by myself and my colleagues. We use the series capacitor as a meander slot in the top wall of the antenna. We use here two pairs of pins, and playing with all the elements, we found such transmission line with the first band that is matched, not exactly. The band gap is about 15 megahertz. In the second band, the band gap is a bit higher, about 100 megahertz, but that structure relatively. So here is the model in the CST fabricated structure, and the calculated and measured radiation patterns. But the problem with the first design of the antenna was the spurious radiation that was due to the dark reflection, so in the left-handed band and the right-handed. So at this frequency it was 15.5, the antenna should radiate. The wanted radiation pattern is here, but this is the unwanted radiation. Similarly, you see that we saw that spurious radiation in measurement. So we designed the new structure with the shorter lengths of the cell, and we postponed that Bragg condition to the band at which there is no radiation. But here I will, switch to the way to show how we can get the dispersion characteristic. For the periodic structure, dispersion characteristic is the dependence of frequency at which the wave can propagate based on the propagation constant, or of course vice versa, dependence of the generally complex propagation constant on frequency. And that dispersion characteristic can show you clearly the band structure of that transmission line, the pass bands at which the wave can propagate, stop bands that there is no wave propagating, for fast wave, for beta lower than K0 we have radiation, for slow wave beta greater than K0 and there is no radiation. Okay, for that general transmission line, as I showed you, the propagation constant is plus or minus S times second root of Zs times phi p, that is J times beta. And analytically, we can determine, according to the Collins work, the dispersion characteristic, knowing the ABCD matrix of particular cells of their periodic structure. So from that ABCD matrix, we can, using the Fokker theorem, we can determine the dispersion characteristic in this form, cosine of gamma times d is a plus d divided by 2. And we can determine the A matrix from, for example, a equivalent circuit or from the calculated or measured S or Z matrices of that cell. Okay, here is the result of the calculation of the dispersion characteristic of this structure. And this is the way how we can use CST Microwave Studio to determine the dispersion characteristic, or namely the eigenmode solver in that simulator. So we have periodic transmission line. We take care of one cell of the length d. We can take it out, and it is in fact our resonator. We apply here periodic boundary condition with the set phase difference phi. That phase determines the phase constant beta, it's phi over b. And it is resonator, we calculate its resonant frequencies, and that's all. We have dispersion characteristic, that resonant frequency as a function of that angle phi or the phase constant beta. So the problem is that, for example, in the CST Microwave Studio, the eigenmode solver is able to determine only real resonant frequencies. So it uses only lossless structure and calculates real resonant frequency. CST Microwave Studio is not able to determine complex resonant frequency matter, or imaginary part of that resonant frequency determines the loss. So using that, we can use only a phase constant, not a dimension constant. So we have, okay, for that analytical way, how we can calculate the dispersion characteristic, we will use the ABCD matrix of one cell, and having n cells in the array, the ABCD matrix of one cell is the nth power of the ABCD matrix of the single cell. Now, using the calculation of Okebits matrices, we can determine that matrix of one cell. But as we took starting value was the ABCD matrix of the whole array, that naturally includes coupling between particular cells. So in this way, we can determine the dispersion characteristic that includes coupling, and of course it includes losses due to the radiation in the case of the leaky wave antenna. So for this structure, you see here the convergence of the calculation using 1 cell, 3 cells, 7, 9, and 11. So we found that for that structure it was enough to use 9 cells, and here is the dependence of the attenuation constant. Again, there is no difference between 9 and 11 cells. And here is the result of the calculation. The red line is the phase constant for that procedure with application of 9 cells. Pink line shows that application of the microwave studio, that is only the eigenmode solver, only the phase constant, and the green line is the result of the circuit calculation of that rather complicated equivalent electric circuit, but you see that it corresponds partly to that circuit derived by George Alestereades. But for the attenuation constant, that was only one way to determine the attenuation constant using that calculation with the ABCD matrices. And here is the design of that dual band antenna, the second pattern. Here is the S parameters in the first band, in the second band, that corresponds to the dispersion characteristic. Here, around 9 gigahertz, we have the broadside radiation in the first band. Around 17 gigahertz, we have the broadside radiation in the second band. Okay, here are the comparison of calculated measures, the radiation patterns. You see that at this first band there is no spurious radiation as we had in the first attempt. This is the calculation and measurement of the radiation patterns in the second band. Here you can see some spurious radiation, but in the first case it was of the same level as the wanted radiation. Here it is at least more than 10 dB lower. And this is the comparison of measured and calculated scanning sensitivity in the first and second band. Okay, and that's all I wanted to tell you. I showed you the ways how people design leaky wave antennas using that substrate integrated waveguide, and I showed you the results of my investigation. And thank you for your attention. This is the entrance building of our faculty. The photo was taken in very short time interval, several days, at which some results are in person. So thank you for your attention.